A few weeks ago, I shot a project with Andrew Randall called Eggnog Run. I wanted it to be original while maintaining some sort of a story, because without a story, what do you have? One question I get more than anything, what camera do you use? Today, I'm gonna break down part of the shooting process as well as the decisions that I made, and it all starts with the gear.
First off, we have the Ronin-M, accompanied by the beast of a camera, the Sony a7 III. I paired that with the Sigma 24-70 lens, which had the SERP variable ND filter, and lastly, the Shinobi Atomos monitor to make sure I get those crisp shots.
Expensive, right?
See, the Ronin-M, in my opinion, is the best affordable gimbal for these types of shoots. What makes it so great is the top handle that allows you to hold it with one hand if you're leaning over, say, maybe like a truck bed. Not to mention, it is so stable. You can run with this thing and still get perfect footage. Look how much it's moving in this GoPro shot. And then this is the same shot straight out of the camera with no added stabilization. That's crazy. Only downside is it's kind of old, outdated, and the app is ancient. Also hard to find a good working battery if yours stops working. So it's really a roll of the dice with this gimbal, but if you find a good one, it's worth it. Moving on to the Sony a7 III, and honestly, there's not much to say about it other than it's a beast and I absolutely love it. Capable of shooting 4K, which is what I shot all of my car scenes on to give it a super crisp and clean look. While it can also handle 1080 slow-mo, 4K is ideal for these types of shoots. If your camera doesn't offer 4K, anything 1080 or above will still be crisp. It honestly just all depends on which lens you use, which my lens choice was a 24-70, and it's a must-have. It allows you to get wide shots as well as zoomed-in ones of the car without ever having to stop and switch lenses. What's so great about this lens is it's sharp, light, and has an aperture all the way down to 2.8. Typically, when doing car shoots, you want to keep your aperture around 3.2 to 4.5 so the whole car stays in focus and everything looks crisp. The 2.8 comes in handy when you're doing detail shots as well as close-ups. A must-have vital piece of equipment is the variable ND filter. The whole driving sequence was shot in 4K, 24 frames a second, which means that your shutter speed needs to be double that to get the most motion blur as well as the best cinematic feeling. So in this case, that means it needs to be 1/48, or on most cameras, 1/50. Which means if you're shooting with these settings in any sort of daylight without an ND filter, it's gone. You can just kiss your footage goodbye. It'll be extremely overexposed. If you don't have an ND filter, you can still film at these settings. You would just have to crank up your shutter speed. The only downside is it takes out all the motion blur, and you can also raise your aperture higher, which also takes out all the depth of field and makes your image look a little more flat, but both of them still work. I would recommend a 5 to 10 stop variable ND filter for any daytime shooting. I run the SERP 5 to 10 stop variable ND filter, and I absolutely love it. The last piece of gear that's essential is the Shinobi Atomos monitor. If you've ever used the Ronin-M, then you know how hard it is to see your screen, especially when you're hanging out of a truck or when you're trying to get those low angles. The monitor can clip right onto the Ronin's arm and give you that 4K crisp image so that it makes framing up your subject so much easier. The monitor also has tons of useful features and specs that can help you out, but that's a whole separate video. Now that we know what gear to use and why, let's talk about how to actually shoot the video. I went with a story for mine, as it makes the editing process so much simpler because you have a starting point and an ending point. When shooting, you want to focus on details that will make the car unique and stand out. After all, that's what it was made for. As well as wide shots of the full car to really bring everything together in the edit. Make sure the driver of the vehicle you're filming out of gets creative, not too creative, so you can get different angles of the car. Establishing communication between yourself and the drivers, whether it's a radio or a phone call, will make sure everyone's on the same page and make your life a lot easier. All in all, at the end of the day, there's not really a right way or a wrong way. This is just the process and gear that I use, and it works great for me. There's definitely cheaper and different ways out there to do everything. Hopefully I answered some questions you guys had, and if you have anything else, make sure to leave them in the comments below and I'll get them answered for you. I've got some cool things coming to the channel soon, so make sure you stick around and subscribe. And with that being said, I think this video is a wrap, and we'll catch you on the next one. All right, peace out.